Good to hear everybody's voices, but it's time to get your shoes and get our worship. If you're listening online this morning, or welcome guests as well, as many who are here. We have a number of visitors this morning. Always thankful for those who are with us, and we welcome you back at each and every time you have that opportunity. It's great to have everyone back, or most everyone back, and we look forward to those others. I have a few cards to read this morning before we. The rest of my announcements. One is for Susan Williams says, "Dear church family, I would like to express my sincere thanks to each of you who sent me a card for my big 60th birthday. When I was little, I thought 60 was so old. Sure doesn't seem as old now. But I refused to grow up, or I've received 61 cards, one for each year of my birthday of my life, plus one to grow on. None of those strangers. I must admit I got sprinkled with confetti, not to mention any names, the Rance family. I opened your card in my car. I think I wore it for several days and I'm still finding something. Got me good. P.S. If you didn't get a chance to get me a card, I'm accepting them until the end of the month. Peace for the week. Nice to have you back, Susan. Another one to our church family. Thank you for your prayers, phone calls during, and plans and visits during the last few months as I was dealing with health problems. It's such a blessing to have our church family to be so caring and loving. God bless us. God bless each of you. And Christian love, Charlie and Lois Sheen."
Thank you.
Charlie, Lois, and good to see you this morning. Lots to be thankful for. God bless us. We have a number of birthdays and anniversaries this week. Well, actually, they're all birthdays. Today is Jamie Kevin's birthday. The 7th is Kevin Ranch, Ralph Weir, and Corey Wolfgang's birthday. The 8th is Nathan Januszewski's birthday, and the 9th is Marsha Bailey's birthday. So happy birthday to everyone. Just a reminder that our Bible class is for all ages. It's now in full session on each Sunday morning at 9:30 a.m. and also Wednesday we will have our regular midweek Bible class for all ages that starts at 7 p.m. And following that, we're going to have a farewell gathering for Butch and Jan. And most of you know Butch and Jan have bought a home up in Elyria. They'll be moving there, so we're going to have a little celebration for them here Wednesday evening after conference. A reminder that June 13th is Alyssa Rance's graduation party, and that's at the Newtonia Sportsman's Club following the morning worship. Just a reminder, kids, get your camp applications in, or registrations in. The church will pay for your registration. We want you to be able to attend and have that good experience. But please get them in as soon as you can to Rich. There's also a sign-up sheet on the bulletin board. If you're interested in being part of a small group meeting on Sunday nights, please sign up for that. We're going to attempt to do that, but other congregations have tried that and been very successful. It's good to have a little closer fellowship instead of being in a large auditorium, and so we're looking forward to that. So please don't forget to sign up for those small groups. There will also be one group meeting here on Sunday evening for those who have to work Sunday morning and still need to come to the building to worship. We'll still have a group here for that. Any questions with that, please see one of the elders. I think that brings us to our prayer list. I'll update our prayer list. I may have attendance. If Layla fell and injured her hand and she's at home, she continues to have a hernia. Prayer to Gerald Joy. His health issues continue and he's back in Boston. And Charlie Merkel is still home. Charlie had several stents put in this week in his heart and he's recovering at home, but he's doing well. Also, please add Sandy Brewer to the prayer list. Sandy is having surgery on Tuesday, so she needs to be on the prayer list. Well, let's not forget those men who have been on the prayer list. I know that Randy and Ellen have dealt with health issues involved with Daniel Peel and just so many others. Please make sure you pick up the bulletin and go through the prayer list. I try to read through that during the week and pray for each of those individuals. would ask that you would do that as well. Let's go to God in prayer. Holy Lord, Father, we come to you this morning on behalf of those many who are in need of your blessings, both spiritually and physically. We ask you to be with each one of these mentioned this morning. Please comfort them and strengthen them this week. We ask that you be with those who are responsible for their cares and their cares and ministry. Lord, we also ask you to be with our many men and women who are in the armed forces. Please watch over them. Pray for their safety and their health this week as well. It's in Christ's name we pray. Amen.
Just a quick announcement about church camp. We are planning on having another board meeting to discuss the restrictions that we originally put on everybody as far as masking, social distancing, those types of things. So they're going to plan on meeting to discuss all those things, what we're going to continue to do, what things we may get rid of. So if you have questions on that, see me. We'll probably be having that meeting in the next couple weeks. So if you have kids that you're on the fence on whether they're going to go because of some of the restrictions and those things, hopefully this will make you feel better about it once we have the meeting. And I'll let everybody know what we're going to do from there. So just, I know a few people have asked me about that. We're going to try to make it as normal as we can, but also keep the kids safe. So we're going to have some more discussions before camp starts to figure out what we want to do with those. So just so you guys are updated, and I'll give an update once we have the meeting and let everybody know that. Let's go ahead and start our psalm service with "I'll Call Upon the Lord." I will call upon the Lord, who is worthy to be praised. So shall I be saved from my enemies. The Lord liveth, and blessed be the rock, and let the God of my salvation be exalted. The Lord liveth, and blessed be the rock, and let the God of my salvation be exalted.
go to God in prayer. All loving Father in heaven, our hearts are made to rejoice this morning when we see so many people that have gathered together to praise your high and holy name and glorify you. Father, we thank you for everyone that is in attendance. We thank you so much, Father, for the young people, the middle-aged people, and those of us that are older. We were able to gather this morning to study from the Holy Word. We thank you, Father, for the teachers that taught the classes. And Father, we ask that you would help us to have a passion to want to learn your word, to want to study your word. Father, we want to thank you for this wonderful opportunity. We thank you, Father, for the wonderful fellowship that we can have you, your Son, your Spirit, for the fellowship that we can have with one another through our worship and our communion. Father, we want to praise you. We want to honor you in everything that we do in our worship this morning and pray that it'll be acceptable to you. Father, we thank you for our elders. Thank you for the time they spend in trying to figure out ways in which they can better shepherd this flock. We pray your continued blessings upon each one of us. Father, we pray that you would bless Gary as he delivers the message of the hour. Open up our hearts, our minds, that we might be receptive to your word, Father. Father, we pray that you always give us a passion to want to assemble, to worship, and to praise you. Father, we have so many in this congregation that are suffering from different illnesses, physical problems. We ask your blessings upon them and pray, Father, that you would help us to be an encouragement in whatever way we can. Father, we also have so many that have left you. We pray that somehow we might have the passion to try to go out to seek them, to bring them back into the fold, Father. Help us, Father, to be the type of people that will honor you. Help us to be the type of people, Father, that will care about each other. Help us to be the type of people that will be found going about doing good as our Savior did. Father, we thank you for this country. We pray for it. We pray that you'll have mercy upon us, Father, as a nation that is strayed from the principles upon which this country was founded. Father, we pray that you would be with our leaders, our elected officials, that somehow they might see that the direction they're taking the country is not the direction that will honor you. So, Father, we just pray that somehow their hearts might be touched, their minds might be changed. Father, as we close, we ask you to forgive us of our sins. Help us to be better people. Help us to honor you in all that we do. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Let's prepare our minds for the Lord's Supper to follow as we sing this song. Alas and did my Savior bleed, and did my Sovereign die? Would he devote that sacred head for some?
now is the time that we partake of the bread and the wine, the Lord's Supper. Jesus was celebrating the Passover with his disciples. The unleavened bread was part of the feast of the Passover from Egypt. And the blood, the fruit of the vine, the blood, was from slaughtering the lamb and marking the doorpost. In that celebration, Christ breaks the bread and he says, "This is my body." And he partakes of the fruit of the vine, and he said, "This is my blood. It is the blood that is shed for us." His body goes to the cross, and his blood is shed for us. There's also obedience in the Passover. There is obedience in the Lord's Supper in our life as Christians. If we are not marked with the blood of Christ, we have to suffer the guilt and the punishment for our sin. This Lord's Supper, the bread, his body, the fruit of the vine, his blood, is for our sin, so that we can live eternally with him. Let's bow together and pray the bread. Our great Heavenly Father, Lord, we praise you, and we thank you for being our God, and we thank you for sending Jesus Christ, your Son, as our Savior. We thank you for this bread that represents that peace and represents Christ's body that was sacrificed for us. Thank you for the life that you give us through that, that we have hope in our lives, that we have salvation, forgiveness of sin, and eternal life with you in heaven. It's in Jesus Christ's name that we pray and partake. Amen. Our great Heavenly Father, the emblem of the fruit of the vine that represents Christ's blood, that he was willing to go to the cross and shed for us, that blood would wash us in our baptism, that blood would continually wash us as we strive to live as faithful Christians. We thank you for that. And it is in Jesus Christ's name that we pray.
Unto thee, O Lord, do my God, I trust in thee. Let me not be ashamed, let not my enemies triumph over me. Yea, let none that wait on thee be ashamed.
Jekyll is a good man, a distinguished physician, well respected in the community, but inwardly his heart is filled with sinful desires. He has a struggle, an internal conflict that he just can't repress, so he creates a drug that allows himself to be separated from Dr. Jekyll and Mr. Hyde. During the day, he's Dr. Jekyll. He's a good man. Well liked. Oh, but in the night, he's Mr. Hyde. And he terrorizes the streets of London. Now, the problem is that when the drug wears off, he becomes Dr. Jekyll again. And he discovers two things which I think are apropos. Number one is, he realizes that he could not amputate his conscience by becoming Mr. Hyde. The second thing that he realizes is this, that the liberation that he sought, that is a liberation without boundaries, without restraint, had become a greater bondage. Are you listening? And these are his last words. He said, "This is the last time I, Dr. Henry Jekyll, can write my own thoughts. I must hurry. I must write them down so that my story can be told unless Mr. Hyde finds out and rips the story. Oh, wretched man that I am." Now, those aren't the words of Mr. Hyde or Dr. Jekyll. Those are the words of Paul. In Romans, the 7th chapter, in verse number 24. It is Paul, and it might surprise you that Paul utters these words. He says here in verse 24, "O wretched man that I am, who will deliver me from this body of death?" Now, I want to look at that this morning. Why Paul had said this. How could Paul, who was a good man, ever say that, oh, I am a wretched man? And the idea of a wretched man is one who is miserable. Miserable. Unfavored. Depressed. Despair. That is the frustration that ends with Romans chapter 7. He's frustrated. Now, the other word in the Greek means this. I want to mention this. The reason that he is frustrated is because in spite of the effort, no matter how hard he tried, no matter how sincere he was, it always ended in failure. Watch it now. Because, you see, the earnest effort, no matter how hard he tried to please God, no matter how hard he tried to be obedient to God, it always ended in failure. Now, to understand that, I want to mention one or two things. Paul, in the first place, is addressing the law. In other words, he is speaking of himself who is under law. This is Romans chapter 7, verse 1. Notice what he says. Or do you not know, or do you not understand? I want you to know something here. For I speak to those, he said, who are under the law. Now, he's referring to the law of Moses. So he's addressing himself as one before he is converted under the law. And so in Romans chapter 3, he'll say the same thing. Now whatsoever the law saith, it says to those who are, watch the phrase, who are under law. I just want you to understand that he's speaking in the framework of the law of Moses. And what he's saying is the law has authority and dominion and power over the one who is under law. So I don't think he's really talking about the person who is a Christian. I think he's referring to his former self who was under law, and in spite of everything he did, he could not please the Lord. Does that sound strange to you? Because if you notice here, what he'll say in verse 4, therefore, my brethren, you have become dead to the law. Now, let me hold on for a minute with that phrase. Because if you remember in Romans chapter 6, beginning in verse number 1, he says, shall we sin that grace may abound? In other words, since God is merciful and we're under grace, should we give God the business? Should we continue to sin? And he will say, God forbid. Then in verse number 2, he'll say, watch it now, certainly not. How shall we that have died to sin live any longer therein? Now, I want you to see something. I'll come back to this thought for a moment. But when he says you have died to sin, and usually a lot of folks will say this. I think it's wrong, but they'll say this. They'll say, well, you know, you died to sin. You're sort of like dead. You're like a corpse. And if sin that's personified goes into the morgue, it doesn't matter how much he talks to you, you're not talking back. No matter if he says, get up, let's go, you're not going to respond. Now remember, sin is personified. So the thought generally is that you are unresponsive to sin, so how can you sin if you're dead to it? You're like buried, you're dead, you can't respond to that. You still with me? I think what he's really saying, in fact, you know that's not true, because when you get into chapter 6 and verse 14, he's going to say, so whosoever you yield your servants to obey, your servants you are. In other words, he's saying, if you sin, that is, you continue to sin, you live a life of sin, then sin becomes your master. What I think he is saying is simply this. Sin, the master of sin, or sin the master, no longer has any power or authority of you. It's sort of like this. Let's say, as some of you have, that you retired or quit the job. You're no longer an employee, but the next day the boss comes and said, you need to come to work today. Well, the boss no longer has any authority over you. Or if you go back into kind of context, if the slave master says, You're to go back into the fields today, though you have been liberated, you have been set free, you're no longer a slave. The plantation owner or the master no longer has power, authority, or dominion over you. Does that make sense? He is not saying, because I want you to understand this, if you understand it this way, that sin no longer has power over you, you're going to find out that's not true. Hello? You're going to find oftentimes it looks like you are, that sin has power over you, it influences you, and you wonder why in the world you keep doing it. Am I talking to the right people? So I believe what he's really saying is that sin personified no longer has any authority or power over you. So what in the world are you obeying him? Roger, why would you go to work? I don't care if you get a call at 4 o'clock in the morning and says, Roger, we expect you to be here today. You say, hey, man, I quit. I'm retired. If, because, I don't want to be redundant here, but it's so important for you to understand this. Because he's not saying that sin doesn't have power, because we all know that it does. That's why he says, if you yield your members to obey, then you become a slave. And so what you see in Romans chapter 6, I'm trying to get you to understand before we get further into the text. What you see in Romans chapter 6, that in the framework of the law, that Paul is no longer under the law, and so he is no longer a servant to sin. For instance, if you see Romans chapter 6, and I'm moving pretty quick here this morning, so slow me down if you need to. But in Romans chapter 6, you remember that it says the wages of sin, sin personified, sin is portrayed as a harsh, ruthless paymaster. And at the end of the day, you get paid. He doesn't pay you in coin, but he pays you in death. The wages that you have earned, the wages that sin is going to pay you with is death. That's why Paul says in Romans chapter 7, in verse 7 and 11, sin killed me. Because you see, under the law, sin is personified, and what he had found out, in spite of all his efforts to be good, no matter how hard he tried. Now I'm saying this because it's going to be very important. Because if you are trying to keep the law, or you're trying to just be obedient to what God says, you're going to find out, I believe, not too long from now, probably tomorrow or next week, you didn't do it. Now, just in case somebody runs out of the building and says, you know what Brother Bailey said today? It doesn't matter if you disobey God. That's not what I'm saying. In other words, obedience is important. Just say amen to that. I want you to say amen because I don't want you lying next week. Obedience is important. But if you are depending on obedience to be saved instead of the cross, you're going to be in some deep trouble because we know that's the truth. Hello? That's why John says in 1 John, writing to Christians, if you say you have no sin, you make God a liar because God says you do. Did you catch that? If you say you do not sin, then you're making God a liar because God says you do sin. Now, what he's going to talk about here is in the framework of the law, under the law, I'm speaking to those who are under the law. I'm addressing those who are under the law. I'm speaking to those who know what the law says. So I want you to get that sort of cemented in your mind for a moment. He is not talking about the Christian who struggles with sin, That's not the contrast here. Because the fellow who is struggling with sin in Romans chapter 7 is defeated by sin. Notice Romans 6 for just a moment. Let's get a little doctrinal here. If you look at verse number 16, do you not know to whom you present yourselves slaves to obey? You are the one, the slaves to whom you obey. Kind of a hard wording, isn't it? Whether of sin, the master, leading to death, that's what you get paid at the end of that chapter. If you obey the harsh slave master, then it will lead to death, and the wages of death, or wages of sin, what sin the paymaster pays is death. Now, does that sound like he's talking about a Christian? Notice further, but God be thanked that you were slaves to sin. When was that? When you were under the law, when you weren't converted. Now, I'll say this, but I'm not getting into this morning, but I want you to understand this. You were never under the law. The law was given to the Jews only. You were never under the law of Moses. The Gentiles were never under the law of Moses. The problem, though, is writing to Christians who were Jews who were hanging on to the law, and they were trying to influence others to come under that system. So he reminds those under the law, you understand what the law says. Now his point is you're dead to the law. You were once slaves to the law, but now you are free. So he'll go into verse number 18. You have been set free from sin. You see, he's not talking about those now that are under the law in that verse. You are free from the master of sin. You are no longer in that framework. You have been set free. For when you were, verse number 20, slaves of sin, you are now free in regard to righteousness. Now watch. In Romans 7, what he does, if you see, and do you not know, brethren, that for I speak to those who know the law, that the law has dominion, has rule, has power, has jurisdiction, has legal claims over the one under the law. And so he uses the marriage illustration that is under the law. He's not dealing with all the exceptions that were under the law, Deuteronomy 24. Are you still with me now on this? I know it can get confusing. Paul is just giving a simple illustration without dealing with all the nuances under the law in regarding the marriage law. But what he says here is that the law has dominion over a man as long as he lives. Now, the idea simply is this. Let's say that Marcia and I are Jews under the law. She is bound to me as long as I'm alive. But if I die under the law, she is free to marry again. Not dealing with them. I'm not into that whole business right now. Not dealing with all the exceptions that were under the law. Just say amen if you're still awake. Okay? So that's why he concludes in verse 4 again that now you are dead to the law. Now the second point I want to make that helps understand is this. Though Paul says in Romans chapter 7 and verse 12 that the law was holy and good, still there is a connection between the law and sin. Because what you're going to see, you'll see in verse number 11, for sin. Now, every time you see sin here, I want you to think of a personification. By that, you get human qualities or something that isn't human. For instance, you might use it in a way that a tree talks to you. If that's happening, we'll get counseling later. But the idea is that sin is personified. And what's happening in this verse is sin took advantage of the law. Even though the law was good, sin became like a prosecuting attorney, took occasion by the law because you violated the law to bring death. That make sense? Okay, so what he says here is this. For sin taken occasion by the commandment, that is of the law, deceived me and it killed me. Okay, so that's what the law was doing. In other words, sin, I'm going to do it this way. Sin, Mr. Sin, if you will, took the law as an instrument or a weapon to kill you. Okay, so that's the idea there, that the law, through the law and all of that business. Now, the thing I want you to think about here is, because it's my contention, or at least my experience over a great number of years now, is that some people really wrestle with their salvation. Now, we're talking about good people. We're not talking about people who walk in darkness. We're not talking about people who are living without God. We're talking about the good person who is striving to serve the Lord, who is a Christian. So what Paul will say here, and again, what he's going to do is, I want you to understand something. He's saying that when I was under the law, I was trying to fulfill the law, and in every attempt, I failed. But we're not saying that he was like the prodigal son. We are saying that he was sincere. He was doing his best. He was going to church, so to speak, every Sunday. He was reading his Bible. He was praying to God. And yet what he found out was, what he discovered, in spite of all that, in spite of all the effort, in spite of all the sincerity, he realized that he was unable to keep the law to be saved. That's why he said, when the Bible said, thou shalt not covet, it dawned on him, he discovered that he was in trouble. Oh, let me do this one. I was only 23, or was 23, when I came into the church. I didn't know how bad a sinner I was until I got in the church. Because everybody knows. Does that make sense to you? I mean, I didn't know I was as bad as I thought. I wasn't a good guy, but I didn't think I was really that bad, and still I started reading the Bible. Does that make sense to you? All of a sudden I found out there's a whole lot of stuff in here I ain't doing. So what Paul said, you know, when the law said thou shalt not covet, he realized, I'm in trouble because I covet. Now let's do it this way. How many of you really realize that even coming to church and doing everything, you're sincere in your efforts, you're making every attempt to really love the Lord and to do what's right? Nevertheless, if you're relying on that obedience and on that principle, you're in trouble. Okay? Just say amen for a minute. Is that the truth? In spite of being sincere and trying to do what's right, trying to treat people in the right way, in spite of all of that, you realize you stumble and fall at times. Well, if that happens, now, the second thing I want to notice here, notice in verse, where it's chapter 7. Now, what Paul's going to do is this. Number one is, in spite of all the attempts and the effort that I've made, I still mess up as far as keeping the law. Then he's going to say something very interesting. He's going to say, I don't even live by my own rules. Here's what he says. Watch it here. Now this is going to sound like this is you. I know it is. Watch what he says. Verse number 15. For what I am doing, I do not understand. That's a hard word to translate from the Greek, because it's not that I don't understand what I'm doing. I just don't understand why I did it. Have you ever done that? I mean, what was I thinking? I mean, how many times have you done something? Well, here's the problem I have. The problem that I have, Marshall will agree with you, that I'm impulsive. I mean, I know I shouldn't do this. I know I shouldn't be rash. I know I should think it through. And yet I don't know how many times that I have done dumb things that I said I'm never going to do it again, and I still do it again. I don't understand. Yeah, I understand what I'm doing, but I don't understand why I do it. Well, I keep doing the same dumb things over and over and over again, and I don't get it. Anybody like that? There you go. So he says, for what I'm doing, I do not understand what I will do. In other words, here's what he's saying. Here, I want to do this. I desire to do this. I'm determined to do this. I am resolved to do this. I'm never going to do it again. And he says, I want to do it, that I do not practice. Good night. What I even hate. I mean, I don't want to do it. Guess what? I end up doing it again. How about you, Bill? Yeah. I know I'm not the only guy here, right? So the next verse says, then if I do what I do not want to do, then he says, I agree with the law that it's good. Now watch it here. Even though I'm doing what the law doesn't say to do, I still agree that God's right. I don't say, oh man, this is God's fault, because I still agree that the Bible's right. Even though I violated, even though I have sinned, I'm not going to say, well, this is... Now the next verse. Verse 17. But now it's no longer I who do it, but sin that dwelleth in me. For I know that in me, that is in my flesh, nothing good dwells, for the will is present again. But how to perform what is good, I do not. Do you see the conflict? Okay? Now, I am saying, I don't want to lose you here. Now, we're kind of in an academic lesson today. But what he's saying, I want to do this, I will to do it, I'm determined to do it. There we go again. There we go again. How many have done something you said, I'm not going to do it again? Every time you walk by the refrigerator. All right, now, if I do what I will not do, or I don't want to do, if I'm doing what I don't want to do, Paul says this, it is no longer I, in other words, I'm talking about, look, the real me, the real guy, if you look at me in general, that's not me. So when I'm doing this, it's not like I'm doing this all the time. But I find out on occasion, I'm doing this stuff I don't want to do. Now, he's kind of redundant in that verse, but watch now. For I find the law. Now, this is what I, here now, he's not talking about the law of Moses. It's sort of a rule of thumb for me. I don't want to use second nature or it's my nature, because that could be misleading to some folks. But he's just saying, you know, I can't even keep my own rules. This law here that I have for myself, this code of ethics, I don't even keep that. I don't even keep, I not only do I break the law of Moses or the law of God, but I even can't keep my own law. That's why he says, for I find in the law that is evil is present me, that one who wills to do good, for I delight in the law of God according to the inward man. And yet he says in the next verse, yet there's another law, which isn't the law of Moses, it's my law, And yet what I find, Roger, is I can't even keep my own rules. I don't allow it in others. I don't allow it in me. And yet I find what I don't allow, I still do. Does that, do you see the problem here? Now, when you get to this point, now here's what I want to get, here's the profound point today. Write down profound point. Here's the deal. When you get to this moment where you say, I can't live up to this. As hard as I've tried to do what's right, as much as I want to serve God, when you get to this moment and you say, I can't do it, this becomes a very big moment or crisis in your life. Because when you get, when you say, I'm going to hell, it doesn't make any difference. I can't do it. There's no use. I quit. That's the temptation. That's where the devil wants you to be. When you look at your life and say, good night. I've tried. I meant to do this. I intended to be at worship. I was going to do all these different things. Finally come to the point, as much as I want to do it, I haven't done it. Critical moment. Because there is a temptation at this moment to give up. To walk away. So I've had it. There's no use. Temptation. Now the second thing is that I want to be very careful here, is if you don't watch this, you can slip into a kind of self-righteousness. I don't mean pompous, arrogant, pharisaical, but the problem here is when you look at this, is that it's sort of like Luke 18 where Jesus talks about the Pharisee that goes up to the temple to pray and he trusted in himself that he was righteous. Because when you get to this point, you say, I'm either given up or you fall into a trap of becoming legalistic. Now, what do I mean by this? Well, you might be saying this. I go to church. I give him my money. I said in the Bible class, I don't chew or smoke, I don't drink beer, and I don't go with women to do.
I don't smoke and I don't chew and I don't go with the girls who do.
There you go. Aren't you glad, Bonnie? If you're not careful here, you can become very legalistic in what you're doing. And you begin to trust in the things that you're doing and maybe inadvertently become very legalistic. Now, when I say legalistic, I don't mean disobedient. What I mean by that is all of a sudden you are depending on what you are doing to be saved. You are depending, I've already said this. I was baptized. I teach Bible class. These are good things. I'm doing this type of stuff. And if you, can I say it again? If you are not careful, you can become legalistic, depending on what you are doing instead of depending on what God had done on the cross. It's so critical you understand this. You're either, when you get to a point where you say, no matter what I do, I mess up. I mean, you are making a real effort. We're not talking about people that are just drifting along, roaming along. Religion doesn't mean really anything to them. God's not important. We're talking about people who really want to do what's right. If you're not careful, you can start depending on what you are doing instead of what God has done. Now, what happens in this framework of the law, from Romans chapter 7, verse 1 to 8, 1 and 2, you'll notice when he gets to chapter 8 and verse 1, he'll say, therefore, in conclusion, there is no condemnation to those who are in Christ. Now, here's the point. He's using, watch it now, because it's going to be real important to you. What Paul is doing is using judicial language, court terms. Condemnation is the conviction of a criminal and the sentence is death. It's court terms. In other words, you have come into the court. You are in a legal framework. And the person who is in Christ, the verdict comes out not guilty. Now stay with me for a moment. Understand that the guilt which leads to the condemnation is legal guilt. We're not talking about how some of you are struggling emotionally with some of the dumb things you did when you were a teenager. We are not talking about emotional guilt. We are not talking about, man, I'm haunted by the things I did when I was a kid. Or I just can't live with myself because of what I've done. That's emotional or psychological guilt. What we're talking about in the Roman letters, especially chapter 7 down to chapter 8, is the going into the court of law. And the prosecuting attorney says, you are guilty, but because you are in Christ, you are not guilty. There is no condemnation. And when he uses that little word, no, there is not a whit of condemnation. I don't care what you've done in the past. I don't care how big your sin was. There is not even a blimp of condemnation. In Hebrews chapter 8, he'll say in verse 12 that he has forgotten your sins and your iniquities, and he will remember them no more. You are not going to bring, God is not going to bring up your sins that you did in the past. You are no longer guilty. You don't have to worry about the sheriff coming. Nobody's going to be knocking on your door at 9 o'clock. You are free. You walked out of the court. You are free from legal guilt. Now, you may wrestle with emotional guilt. You may regret it. You may say, boy, if I had $10,000, I would change that day. I would do anything to change some of the dumb things I did. That's emotional guilt. What the writer in Hebrews Romans is doing is you are no longer under the condemnation or legal guilt because you're in Christ. Now, let's do one more thing. When you get to 1 John, he's not dealing in the same kind of agenda here, but let's do this. He begins in verse number 6 by saying, chapter 1 and 6, if you walk in darkness, then you do not have fellowship with God. What does he mean? He means that if your manner of life is to live your lifestyle, if your manner of life or your lifestyle is to walk in darkness or in sin, then you do not have fellowship with God. If you're living that way, you're Mr. Hyde. You don't have fellowship with God. That is, you do not have redemptive, saving fellowship with God. But if you walk in the light, that is your manner of life, is living the way God wants you to live, Then you have fellowship one with another. That is, you have fellowship with God. And his blood cleanses you, notice, from your sin. So you, even though you are walking in the light, are you with me? His blood cleanses you from your sins. Now what does he mean? I want you to understand this. If I'm walking in darkness, I walk away from God. I'm out getting drunk, chasing women, living a life without restraint. He said, you don't have any fellowship with God. That's why he says in Romans 8, there's no condemnation to those who walk not after the flesh. Don't fool yourself here. John is saying, they ain't going to cut it. But if you're walking in the light with the Lord, and you sin, thanks, Kathy. Who knows, I might make the movies. If you walk in the light as he is in the light, then his blood continually cleanses you from your sin. Now let me give you the Greek here, it's real important. When he says, listen, can you listen to me? You don't have a yo-yo existence with God. One day you're saved, the next day you're not. It's not like a dot. The linear is not like dot, 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 dot. It's a straight line. You are constantly, continually cleansed by the blood of Jesus. What that's to do. In other words, if you mess up, you're not all of a sudden out of fellowship with God. Because his blood, it's like those, what's that stuff they put on windshields? Rain-X. Tom, you be quiet back there. I don't know what you're... It's constantly cleansing. And even that's not a good illustration because it kind of misses a little. But you are continually cleansed. Now when he says, if we confess our sin, and the problem in 1 John is they were denying their sins. They were saying we have no sin. That's why you make God a liar. Now you see this, brethren. If you are walking in the light with the Lord, even when you sin, don't leave and say, okay, now we can sin. I know somebody's going to say that. You are constantly cleansed by the blood of Jesus. You are no longer legally guilty. There is no accusation that can be brought against you. There is absolutely no condemnation to those who are in Christ. That's why he says, oh, wretched man that I am, who can deliver me from this body of death? Thanks be to God for Jesus Christ. You can have hope. Now notice, I'll have to say this and then I'll let you go. I want you to understand, Paul is not contrasting the struggle with sin under the law and the struggle with sin as a Christian. What he's contrasting is, yeah, we struggled under the law, but it wasn't just a struggle, we were defeated by it. The Christian isn't. He's been liberated, he's been set free, and there's no condemnation. And you can know you're going to heaven. Well, I know that's a kind of a tough chapter, dude. But boy, if you get a grip on it, you can have the peace, and you can have the hope, you can have the assurance, and the certainty that God wants you to have. Now, for those who are in Christ, he mentioned that's certainly by faith, and in Romans 6, he'll talk about, know you not, that when you were baptized, I don't have time to get into this, but can I just suggest this? Baptism isn't an isolated event, which most religions make it. It isn't out there by itself. What the Bible says is this, that God in the waters of baptism takes away your sin. In other words, baptism isn't only something you do, an isolated event, but it's something that God is doing also. We were risen by the faith in the work of God, buried with him in baptism, and now he says, now you can walk in newness of life. Let me do it again, because I know this could be confusing. I want to say it. Baptism is not an isolated event. It's not just something you do as an act of faith, but God is doing something also. And the way you get into Christ, know you not, do you not understand that when is the time? Do you not know that when you were baptized, that's the event, the two things, time and event. Do you not know that when you were baptized, you were baptized into Christ? And there's no condemnation to those who are in Christ who walk not after the flesh. Okay? Okay. Okay, I'm going to let you go. I want to encourage everybody here before we do that. Of course, be right with the Lord. Time just flies. But I want to encourage everybody here to be in worship every Sunday. I want to encourage everybody here to be in Bible class. Bible class is in Sunday school for just kids. It's important for you to be here. It's important for you to be here. That you make every effort to be here. Make every effort, strive to do what God wants you to do. Okay? That's my commercial. So if you're here today and you need to respond, we certainly want you to do it. Think about it. Think about it. Walking away without any condemnation. And if you die tonight, you'll be at home with God as we stand and sing.
Bring Christ your broken life, so marred by sin. He will create anew, make whole again. Your empty, wasted years, he will
and none that
Have you ever stood at the ocean with a white foam at your feet? Felt the endless thundering motion? Then I say you've seen Jesus my Lord. Have you seen Jesus my Lord?
Thank you, Lord, for this day. Just thank you for giving us the opportunity to come here today and to worship you and to learn about you, Lord. And please just be with us as we go out this week, and please just let us be able to strive to be the people we should be, Lord, to show others you, Lord. Just thank you for everything you've given us. Just thank you for the ability to be able to come back to normal, as you want to put it, as we can be, Lord, and to be able to see people and be able to congregate with one another again, Lord. Just thank you for everything. So that's how you pray.